I do believe that there are many people who are seeking answers from the Lord among us this morning. So we'll take time for prayer after my message. Exodus chapter 14, verses 10 through 15. And when Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them. So they were very afraid, and the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. Then they said to Moses, "Because there were no graves in Egypt, have you taken us away to die in the wilderness? Why have you so dealt with us? So bring us up out of Egypt. Is this not the word that we told you in Egypt, saying, 'Let us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians'? For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness." Then Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall see again no more forever." Amen. Can we read that verse together? Amen. If you're looking at your Bible, read with me. And we're going to receive that a promise into our lives this morning as we read. Amen. Read along with me that one, just that one verse. Maybe it's on the screen. The Lord. And Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today." Say today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, say today, you shall see again no more forever. Say forever. Forever. Amen. The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. Amen. Hallelujah. All of us know about the wonderful way in which God set his people free from the land of Egypt. When we read Deuteronomy chapter 26 and verse 8. This is what we read there. "So the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and with an outstretched arm and with great terror and with signs and wonders." All of you know about the signs and wonders that God did on behalf of his people, the Israelites in the land of Egypt, the 10 plagues that came on the land of Egypt, and how God marvelously separated his people from the Egyptians and erected a wall of fire so that none of these plagues will affect his people, the Israelites. While the Egyptians had no water to drink, when the water had turned red, Israelites still had water to drink. When the land was covered with darkness in the Egyptian quarters, there was light still in the Israelite quarters, actually slums. When plagues after plagues were coming upon these people on the Egyptian side of that divide, God, in his divine provision, made sure that his people were not affected. That's why, looking back many times in the Old Testament, we see the same phrase repeated again and again. God set them free from Egypt what did we read in verse 6? 26 and verse 8. With a mighty hand and with an outstretched arm. So, you know, when you see so many miracles of God, and then finally they had the celebration of the Passover, and they left from Egypt and they started marching through the desert, you know, they were holding their head high. They were very happy for what God had done on their behalf. When you read Exodus chapter 14, look at verse 8. At the end of verse 8, depending on the version of the Bible that you are looking at, this is what we see there. The official version, we use New King James Bible as an official version in this church. So this is what it says there. And the children of Israel went out with boldness. With boldness. King James Bible says the children of Israel went out with a high hand. Naturally, they had the high hand, right? Because God was on their side. God was supporting them. God was doing things for them. All they had to do was become an eyewitness for the marvelous things that God were doing on their behalf. Amen. Amplified Bible says they were leaving confidently and defiantly. Interesting. And NIV Bible says they were marching out boldly. See, I mean, when you see God working on your behalf, your attitude change. You have confidence, amen? And you have faith. Your faith increases. Doubts disappear. And your faith increases. And you feel good. And you hold your head high. And tell everyone that God is on my side. What can man do unto me? Amen? If the Lord is for me, what can man do unto me? That will be our testimony. But you know, something that happens in human life happened in the life of Israelites. That's where this message comes from. Because we are all emotional people. Amen? And emotion is something that goes up and comes down. It's very difficult to be at the same level emotionally in our lives. It doesn't matter how old you get. It doesn't matter how many years you are a Christian. It doesn't matter how long you know the Lord. Your emotions change. Emotions will have an impact on you. Amen? And look at this. Look at this. These people who are holding their head high and walking boldly, walking defiantly, you know, turning back and saying, uh-huh, did you see that? You know, I mean, when I was reading that passage, what came to my mind was one of these movies, the Eddie Murphy movies, you know, turn around, you know, give the actions that he do, you know, see that, see what I did, you know, see what, I mean, they were so defiant about what God had done for them. But only until Pharaoh came after them. Amen? The confidence disappeared in a second. The defiance disappeared in a second. The boldness melted in a second. In verse 10 that says, look at this. Israelites lifted their eyes. And behold, the Egyptians were marching after them. So they were very afraid. Sorry. Typical human story, right? One day we are singing, you know, I mean, marvelous songs about God's faithfulness, about what God has done for us, and you cannot wait to testify about how good God has been. And then you see the Pharaoh and his army marching after you. Are you getting what I'm saying? Are you asleep? Okay. I thought you'd be a little excited this morning. Amen? Praise God. I want you to come with me because this happens to all of us. One day we feel like on the mountaintop. Then the next day we feel at the bottom of the pit. And that's the toll emotions take upon us. And listen, not that they hadn't seen anything. Not that they didn't know what God could do for them. These are people who are witnessing the marvelous things that God did in the mighty land of Egypt, which was a superpower of that generation. How God humbled them. How God brought Pharaoh to his knees. And whereas the children of Israel had nothing in their hand, no way to defend themselves, God alone was their defense. But they ended up having victory. Amen? How many times God has come through for you? Come on, speak to me. How many times God has come through for you? I'm glad. I'm glad you responded. I'm glad you clapped your hands. Now I'm going to ask you a question. If that is true, if your clapping is your testimony, then why do your face go when the next problem comes? Tell me, if you have seen God's goodness so many times in your life, how come when the next problem comes, your praise disappear, your prayer disappear, your faith disappear? Thank you. At least one person is on my side. Why do we react like that? Amen? Because is your God dead this morning? Is Jesus dead this morning? No. Do you believe Jesus is still alive? Yes. Do you believe Jesus is still on the right hand side of the Father? Yes. Do you still believe Jesus Christ is your high priest? Yes. Do you still believe Jesus Christ is pleading your case on behalf of the Father? Hallelujah! So why do we get scared so fast? If I borrow a phrase from David, why do you cast down so quickly, oh my soul? Why do we do that? Because there's so many things that God did for them. Amen? But as soon as they saw Pharaoh and his army marching after them, they became very afraid. See, from very bold to very afraid in a matter of minutes. That's what life deals with us. That's what life does to us. Amen? Because we do not have everything going our way, despite what the songs say. Amen? Hallelujah. And not only that, the children of Israel started complaining. What did they say? Didn't we tell you to leave us alone? Why did you bother to come to us and tell us all these promises? Why did you tell us that Jesus heals? And while I still have to suffer sickness, why did you tell us that Jesus can set you free when I'm still struggling? Why did you tell us that Jesus can change your situation while we are still struggling financially? There comes a moment when you turn against the preacher. You know, and people turned to Moses and said, didn't we tell you to leave us alone? Yes, we were living in slums. Yes, we were in slavery. Yes, we all day long, we had back-breaking labor. But at least there was security under the protection of Pharaoh. Why did you break that security? Why did you bring us here? And they look at the circumstances, and that's when they started questioning Moses. But this is the point you have to understand. When they started questioning Moses, they were not questioning Moses. They were questioning God. Remember, Moses was a reluctant message bearer. He didn't want to go and tell them that God has visited him. He didn't want to go and tell them that God has prepared a place for them. They didn't want to tell them that they're never going to go to a promised land, their land filled with milk and honey. But God had to convince him and make him the message bearer. But guess what? Even Moses started crying. Look at this. This is very interesting. Let me tell you what happens to leaders when similar situations like this happen. Are you still with me? Okay, look at verse 13. And Moses said to the people, do not be afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall see again no more forever. The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. So what is Moses doing there? Come on, tell me. What is Moses doing there? Moses is making a bold proclamation. Moses is lifting up the spirit of the people so they can trust in God again. They can have faith in God again. Do you still have your Bibles open? But look at the first sentence. In verse 15, then God came down and God said, Moses, why are you crying? Hey, when you look at verse 13 and 14, you don't see Moses crying. Moses is telling them and making a bold proclamation, which is the basis of our message today. But when God looked at Moses, God saw Moses crying. Are you with me? So you know what that means? When you are in a leadership position, you don't want to see anybody, you don't want to show anybody that you are sweating. Amen? Don't let them see you sweat is one of the things that they teach you when they teach you about leadership. Amen? In front of people, Moses is putting a bravado and said, God is going to do this. God is going to do this. Today you're going to see the deliverance, and forever you're going to get deliverance. And God looked at him and said, man, you can put that up before people, but I see the hearts. I see the hearts. I see the hearts. Are you with me? This is something that I am acutely aware of as a pastor. Because when I look at you from here, when I meet you, you know, Sunday morning or after service, all of you are smiling. You are in your Sunday best clothes. And if I look at outside, everything looks fine. Everything looks fine. You would never know that you have issues. Nobody would know that you are going through something. because you don't want people to see you sweat. Because you're afraid, what will they do with that information? Will they start a gossip in the church? How many people they're going to share that news with? The moment you tell them somebody that you have a sickness in your body, you're afraid that how many other people get to know about it? How many phone calls I will have to answer later? You know, so you hide it, right? And you keep smiling. You keep smiling. We are so good at that plastic smile. So good at that plastic smile, you know. Especially in the West, it's where people are much more good at putting up a show in the West. You know? Yeah, I have to tell you, after living here many years, because you see anybody always smiling. They don't know you. You don't know them. You just first encounter, but they're smiling. And we say, hi. How are you? Oh, I'm doing fine. You probably just came out of the doctor's office, heard the worst news of your life, but you never tell people that. Say, I'm fine, and you put that plastic smile on your face. But I want to tell you something. Here, you don't have to put up that smile. You don't have to put up anything. You don't have to pretend. Because we are seated in front of a God who sees everything bare and naked. Who knows exactly where you are this morning. Who knows every burden in your heart. Amen. I do not know how many times you cried last week, but He knows. I do not know how many nights you did not sleep last week, but He knows. I do not know how many doors you knocked on and the doors were not opened, but He knows. So you don't have to show anything. Just be truthful before Him. Open your heart before Him, like Hannah did. Amen. When Eli came and asked Hannah, what are you doing here? What was her answer? I am pouring out my heart before my Lord. And this is the place to pour out your heart before the Lord. Amen. Because you don't need to put up anything. You don't have to put up a show. We don't need to put up a show. Because God is here to deal with our problems. God is here with answers for our issues. And what we need is not a show. What we need is answers. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I do believe God has answers for you today. Hallelujah. I believe today is the day that God is going to come through for you. Amen. I do believe that this world, whatever be that world that you see in front of your life today, you will not see it forever anymore. It's that kind of a deliverance that I'm praying for today. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to show you some very important things. Amen. I'm going to take you. You know, I'm a teacher, so I'm going to teach you some principles from this passage. I'm going to show you about seven main points quickly, and then we will pray. First thing that we're going to notice is two phrases from Moses to strengthen the people in verse 13. Amen, 13 and 14. Two phrases that you need to pay attention to. The first one is stand still. Stand still in verse 13. Second one in verse 14 is hold your peace. Amen. Can you say stand still? All right. Since you are not standing, I'm not going to ask you to do anything. Okay. But when it comes to the second phrase, turn to the person sitting next to you and tell them, hold your peace. Come on, come on, come on. Say it again. Amen. Yeah, turn around and just speak to the other person and say, hold your peace. Moses telling people? You need to give room for God to work. It's very, very important principle. God is ready to take care of your issues. But sometimes you're non-stop complaining that you have no time to listen to what God is saying. How many of you complain all day long? I know nobody will raise hands for that. But you do. Amen? And God is trying to tell you something. God is trying to give you answers. God is trying to answer your petitions. And you keep going babbling. Why did this happen to me? And you calling everyone and you crying. You make a mountain out of a molehill. And God say, hold your peace. Moses said, come on, guys. How many times we saw what this God can do? It's not one miracle they saw. It's not two miracles that they saw. How many miracles they already saw? So stop. Hold your peace. Now, you know what is the funny thing? When he was telling people to hold your peace, he did not have peace in his heart either. That's why God looked at him and said, why are you crying? After telling them to hold your peace, you are crying inside. So we are all affected by our situations. Amen? Hallelujah. Now, you need to give room for God to work. Do you remember the father of John the Baptist? What happened to Zechariah? You know, he kept talking back to God, and God had to sip his mouth and say, you're going to talk yourself out of your blessing. Therefore, I'm going to sip your mouth for a few months. Amen. You're going to talk again only after seeing or witnessing your blessing. Amen. And I have to tell you, many of you do the same thing. Talk yourself out of your blessing. Turn to somebody and say, don't talk yourself out of your blessings. Yeah, it's very important. Amen. Turn to somebody else and say, give room for God to work in your life. Yeah, because it's your words matter. What does Proverbs chapter 18 and verse 21 tell us? Death and life, come on, we all know. Death and life are in the power of your tongue. You can bring life to your life. I mean, you can bring life or you can bring death using your tongue. Are you with me? Praise God. Yeah, that's not my opinion. It's the word. Amen. And the word is established forever in heavens. Amen. So don't talk yourself out of your blessing. You need to hold your peace. You need to calm down. Issues will come. Challenges will come. Because when they left from Egypt, they thought the issues were over. They thought they never have to face it. From here on, it's going to be smooth sailing. Pretty soon we will be in our promised land. Pretty soon we will be in the land of milk and honey. And we don't have to worry about anything. And then all of a sudden, Pharaoh's chariot showed up. And that's what is exactly going to happen in your life. Things will not go the way you expect always. Amen? Praise you, Jesus. Now, let me take you to the question that God asked Moses. Why did God ask Moses, why do you cry? You know why? First of all, God saw that. But there's more to it than that. Moses was a charioteer in Pharaoh's army. Moses went to the Pharaoh's army. Moses was a general in Pharaoh's army. Moses went to the military academy that was run by Pharaoh. So he knew how powerful these chariots were and how marvelous these generals were. If you look the passage, read the passage about that. Amen. Can I look at this verse 9. So the Egyptians pursued them, all the horses and chariots of Pharaoh, his horsemen and the army. And look at verse 6. He took 600 choice chariots and all the chariots of Egypt with captains over every one of them. In other words, Pharaoh did not follow Israel. Listen, we have this big mistake in our mind when we see movies and stuff. Pharaoh did not follow Israelite with the entire army of Egypt. Pharaoh followed Israelites with the best in the Egyptian army. The most highly qualified generals and captains in the Egyptian army. And 600 chariots are coming. And you know, there's somebody driving on the chariot or taking care of the horses, and somebody standing in the chariot and shooting arrows. And Israelites were outnumbered many times. But Israelites didn't have any weapon in their hand. All they had with them was the little belongings they had in Egypt, and they're struggling to carry that, maybe in a sack, maybe on a donkey, maybe on a cow or a bullock or something, and they're trying to carry that little belonging into this new land that they were going to occupy. They did not have any weapons. So they were sitting duck, and Moses used to be one of them. Moses was a charioteer before. That's why he was crying. Moses knew what it would take to defend his people, and he knew he had absolutely nothing to defend his people with. That's why he was crying as a leader inside, because he knew that they were sitting duck. If they start shooting the arrows, people just going to fall down like flies, because there are no way of defending themselves. That's why he was crying. But Moses made a big mistake, which we also make. Sometimes we preach a big sermon, but the sermon doesn't get in our own heart. Amen. God came down and confronted Moses because Moses forgot what he told his people. What did he tell his people? Be still. See the salvation of the Lord. If that's what you're waiting for, what does it matter whether you have arrows or not? Why should you worry how many chariots are coming after you? Because you are not planning to defend them anyway. You're waiting for the salvation of the Lord. So why does it matter how many chariots are coming after you? But Moses forgot, because he was overwhelmed as a leader. And that's why God had to tell him, hey, stop crying. Stop crying. Third thing, verse 15. Look at verse 15. Not only God said, don't cry, but what did God say? Tell the children of Israel to go forward. Ha! Wow. Tell the children of Israel to go forward. When problems come, you're not turning back. You're going forward. When issues come, you're not giving up on your faith. You're going forward. When the enemy challenges you, you're not going back into the world. You're going forward. Turn to somebody and say, I'm going forward. Yes, I have issues in my life. Yes, I have challenges in my life. But I sang a song a long time ago when I came out of the waters of baptism. I sang a chorus, no turning back, no turning back, no turning back, no turning back. And I ain't turning back in the midst of this issue. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let Satan bring his best weapons against you, but you are not going back. How many of you have the confidence to say with me this morning that I am not going back? Hallelujah. How many will look at the face of Satan and tell him squarely, I am going forward? Amen. He's not stopping you. He's not stopping you. He's not stopping you. I said he is not stopping you. I said he is not going to stop you. I said he is not going to stop you. You're going to move forward in life. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Extremely important principle to remember. Don't turn back when issues come. That's when the enemy captures you. That's when the enemy catches you. Amen? Because if you read carefully, if they carefully that passage, we can see that the chariots came, tried to encircle them. That was Pharaoh's plan. Listen to me. That was Pharaoh's plan. Go all around that camp, encircle them. And they're sitting duck then, completely sitting duck. But Israel, when they look forward, all they saw was Red Sea. And they did not understand why God was telling them to move, go forward. But since they had the wisdom to believe God and go with God, Pharaoh could not encircle them. That's the only reason they came out victorious that day. See, the Bible teaches us that we must understand the methods of the enemy. We must understand the schemes of our enemy. Amen. With every trial, there is a way out. Amen. But that way out has to come from heaven. So when the heaven, the command comes from heaven, when God gives you an idea, you just follow it. It may not make sense. It may not make sense. Because why would God tell them to go forward? And if you and me, if you're thinking in the natural, you will turn around and say, what do you mean go forward? What is in front of us? It's Red Sea. So where are we going? No, we need to have a committee meeting. You know, this leader is going crazy. Where are we going? All we have is Red Sea in front of us. You're telling us to go forward. But you know what God was telling them? The moment you decide to do that, the enemy cannot encircle you. That's the only reason why they came out victorious. Today, somebody in here, the enemy has drawn a circle for you. He's hoping that you will stay in that circle and give him enough time to come and encircle you. You need to bust out of there. You need to bust out of there. You need to take steps forward. You have been sitting down for too long. You have been on that couch and crying for too long. You didn't know that while you were doing that, the enemy was making plans to encircle you and keep you inside the circle and then finish you off. Time to bust out. This is the day we're going to bust out of that circle. This is the day we're going to bust out of that circle. Amen. We're going to make a fool out of the enemy. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Amen. Number four. Look at verse 16. The fourth thing that God told Moses was this. You need to exercise your spiritual authority. One of the things that happen when we go through issues is that we forget the fact that we are children of God. One of the things we find what happened is that God has used us in the past. See, the testimonies that you have in your life. See, in the book of Revelation, there is a verse which says that they overcame Satan. Come on. How did they? By the power of the testimony. Amen? Partly. Part of it. So your testimony is supposed to be a weapon for you. Your testimony supposed to bring out the faith in you. The testimony is supposed to wake you up when you are confronted with the next issue. Amen? The testimony is there so that you can look back and say, hey, this is not the first time I went through an issue in my life. This is not the first time I had a challenge in my life. I remember what God did for me last time. Amen. That issue was much greater than this. If God came through for me that, he can do that again. He can do that again. He can do that again. He will do it again. Amen. But Moses forgot about the rod in his hand. You know why? Originally, that was Moses' road. But that road itself had gone through a transformation. That road of Moses had become the road of God. I don't have time to take you through the previous chapters. If you look at the beginning of that story, when Moses had the first encounter with the living God, remember God asked him to put the rod down. Moses asked him, what do you have in your hand? And Moses said, all I have is the shepherd's rod. And God asked him to put that down. And that became a snake. And then God asked him to take it and pick it up again. And then it became a rod again. But you know what? That it was not the same rod after that. See, until then, the rod was only used to bring the branches down so the sheep can eat or just to direct the sheep. But the moment Moses took the rod back, God said, with this rod, you're going to do miracles in Egypt. Are you with me? Moses' rod had become God's rod. And that rod is in his hand. But because of the thick of emotions, he forgot that this is God's rod. And this is the rod that God used to do so many signs and wonders in Egypt. And I have that same rod in my hand, the same rod, the same, which symbolizes the same spiritual authority. Listen, You and I have nothing special about us in the natural. We are humble human beings. But at some point, we became God's property. And we became God's property, and God started using us. Amen. Now when you look back in your life, you can see so many times when God used you. And God, that spiritual authority was imparted into your life. And how that spiritual authority came as deliverance in the life of people. But when we go through situations, you know, sometimes in the thick of emotions, we begin to wonder, who am I, Lord? I'm nothing but a little worm. Am I telling the truth here? No, you're not a little worm. No, you were a little worm. You can see that use with Jacob in the prophecies. God said, you are a little worm. You know, God calls Jacob with a worm. You little worm. You know, in one passage, God calls him. But then God said, but that same worm, when I loved you, became the prince of God. You're not a little worm anymore. You're a child of God. Amen. And as a child of God, you have spiritual authority. Oh, everybody became quiet. How many of you actually believe that you have spiritual authority? Come on. How many of you actually believe that you have spiritual authority? But let me ask you a question. How many times you have used that spiritual authority? It's one thing to know that in your head, but it's another thing to have the confidence to use it. Amen? So what Moses needed was the confidence to use that. And God said, listen, stop crying. Because before you left Egypt, I gave you the answer already in your hand. And the answer is in your hand already. But because the circumstances are so overwhelming, you cannot see the answer that is in your hand. Sometimes the answer is right there, but we cannot see it. Hallelujah. And God had to remind him, Moses, I'm not coming down with a new answer for you, because I already gave you the answer before you left from Egypt. The answer is in your hand. Stretch forth that same rod and see what it will do. And we know the story. Amen. And he stretched forth hands, and the Red Sea was parted, and the children of Israel walked through the dry land. Amen. The fifth thing I want to show you is this. We have to run. Is this. The enemy has no part in your spiritual blessings. Verses 17 and 18. God said, I'm going to harden the heart of Pharaoh and the Egyptians. I will make sure that even when they see you, they can also see that in front of you there is only water, only Red Sea, and they can see you're walking into the Red Sea. But I will harden their heart, because they are wise people, smart people, all these charioteers, generals, captains, they are smart people, but I will harden their heart to follow you into the water, because I have a plan for them. Just like I have a plan for you, I have a plan for them. So I'm going to harden their heart. Amen. And you know why? Because this Pharaoh never gave honor to God. You know, he had so many opportunities to turn around and save himself and his own people. But because he hardened his heart in Egypt, you know, the not only his firstborn died, eventually all the firstborns of the Egyptians died. And they suffered so much loss because of his hardened heart. And God said, I gave him so many opportunities to honor me, but he refused to honor me. But today he's going to honor me. You guys are going to be an eyewitness to what I'm about to do. Amen. Hallelujah. But they may think that because you got a dry land to walk on, they're going to have a dry land. No. That dry land is just for you. Amen. Can you turn to somebody and say, this blessing is just for me? Turn to somebody else and say, this blessing is just for me. Amen. Just because I got a blessing from God, don't come after me. You're going to get yourself in trouble, because God didn't give you that part in that blessing. This blessing is just for me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You
you're going to get stuck. You better stay there. You better stay on the dry ground. Just because I am taking a step of faith, don't just come after me. Because you didn't hear from God. You didn't tell you to take that step of faith. I heard from God. Therefore, I'm taking a step of faith. I'm going to take a step of faith. I'm going to walk into the water. I'm going to walk into the water. I'm going to walk into the water. Because I know something will happen when I walk into that water. But be careful. But be careful. Stay on the dry ground. Because if you just blindly follow me, you're going to get stuck. And when you get stuck, the water is going to come back. Waters always speak of trials in the Bible. It's going to come back. It's going to swallow you up. Huh. How many times this has happened in history? Our time is almost finished. But you know, when Abraham heard the voice of God, Abraham started following, taking steps of faith, taking steps of faith, taking steps of faith. And Lot said, if my uncle is going to a land that God's going to show him, I'm going to follow him. And then he got stuck in Sodom. And we know what happened to Lot and his family in Sodom. So don't follow the people who are taking steps of faith unless you also have heard from the Lord. Are you with me? Amen. Praise God. Because the enemy has no share in your blessings. Turn to somebody one more time and say, this blessing is just for me. Hallelujah. 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 Sixth thing, quickly, in verse 19 and 20. Now listen, this is interesting. Because in verse 15, God told Moses to stretch forth his hands, you know, so that the Red Sea will be parted. But you know, Moses didn't do that right away. You know, I learned a big lesson last week when I was putting this PowerPoint together. I learned a big lesson as a leader. Because sometimes you God start talking and you run ahead of God. You don't wait for God to finish everything. You know, Moses was told in verse 15, but Moses didn't stretch forth his hands right away. He's listening to God. God keep talking. He's listening to God. And you know what was a good thing about it? Look at the next two verses. Verses 19 and 20. And the angel of God who went before the camp of Israel moved and went behind them. And the pillar of cloud went from before them and stood behind them. So it came between the camp of Egyptians and the camp of Israel. Thus, it was a cloud of darkness to the one, and it gave light by night to the other, so that the one did not come near the other all that night. Are you still with me? What was the goal of Israel? What was the strategy of the Egyptians? Not Israel, the Egyptians, to encircle the Israelites and make them sitting ducks and shoot them with arrows and kill them. Amen. Until they can take some of them back into slavery. But that was their plan. But you know, as the enemy is coming forward, and God told them to move forward, they're slowly moving towards the Red Sea. But then God realized the night is coming. Amen. And the night is coming. And in the night, the Israelites, humble people, don't know what to do. So I need to take care of them. So you know what God did? God made a shift. Our favorite verse in the word in this church in 2015. I don't know why the shift woman is sitting all the way in the back. Sister. We have talked between us in 2015 so many times, myself and Sister Minerva, about a shift coming to this church. A shift coming to this church. And so many times when we pray, we hear that just one word. And she will tell me, she will call me and say, Pastor, I was praying. You know what's the word I heard? Shift. And I don't know what that means. And I'll tell her, you know, I was studying Bible. You know what is the word I heard? Shift. I don't know what God is trying to do. And so many times we had that conversation in 2015. Because God is trying to take this church in a new direction. And listen to me. Listen to me. God's promises will be fulfilled, but only after a shift. That's the next principle I want you to remember. God's promises will be fulfilled, but prior to that, there will be a shift. Oh, you didn't get that. Let me say that again. God's promises will be fulfilled, but prior to that, there will be a shift. What happened that night? The children of Israel walking in the front, and there was the fire of God. An angel of God appeared with a light for them, for the entire camp. And God said, no, no, this is not good, because I want to provide light for the Israelites, but I don't want to provide light for the Egyptians who are chasing them. So I need to make a division between them. Amen. So what did God do? God asked the angel of God to stand between the Israelites and the Egyptians. So now that the angel of God is facing Israelites, they have the light. Now the back of the angel is towards the Egyptians, they only have darkness. God made a division. Amen. So what was the shift? The angel was walking in front of them, leading the way. God came from there to the back of the camp of Israel. And God said, I need to make this change before the miracle comes. You know why? Because God wanted to give Israel some time to walk through the dry land. Eventually, Egyptians followed them. Yes. But the Egyptians did not see them walking into that dry land right away. So they couldn't chase after them because the angel blocked their path. You know how many times God allowed you to walk into your blessing and people were chasing you? Amen. People were planning to do you harm, but God put an angel on the road to block their path. God said, give some space to my child. Give some space to my children. Amen. Because they are not able to help themselves. They are not able to protect themselves. I need to do something. They need some space. And God gave them that space. Amen. And listen, finally. Only after, in verse 21, Moses saw the angel coming behind the camp, did he stretch forth his hands for the fulfillment of the prophets. You know why? Because he came from the military school of Pharaoh. He didn't want the Pharaoh's chariot. They couldn't do it. But he still didn't want them to see what is the strategy that's going to be applied for their deliverance. So he waited until the angel came in the back of the camp of Israel. And there was a darkness covering the camp of Egyptians, the chariots of Egypt. Then he stretched forth his rod and the miracle came. Amen. So when the children of Israel finally walking through that dry land, what do you think was actually happening? They were walking through the challenge. Hello. They were walking through the challenge. What was the Red Sea saying? No, I will stop you right here. You're not going to. God had told them to go forward, but the Red Sea was right here. And the Red Sea was saying, no, no, you are not going anywhere. You cannot move forward. I am here to stop you. But you know what God enabled them to do? Walk through the challenge. The waters of Red Sea that challenged them are like big walls on both sides. Wondering, how are they doing this? How are they doing this? I was powerful enough to stop them. Look at how deep I am. Look how much water I have. How come I cannot stop them? They are walking right through me. Walking right through me. Hey, walking right through the challenge. That's what God has in store for you. That's what God has in store for you. Stand up with me all over this.